Do you ever feel like you've seen everything? Yeah, it's an arrogant way to think, but it happens. You fall under the impression that you're the go-to authority on what's worth seeing, what's shit, and what's so bad that it's good. And then it happens. You stumble upon a film, and these exact words spill forth.
Patrick Swayze is the soldier of destiny.
Holy fucking shitballs, how have I never seen this before? Or at least that's what I say. I am a huge fan of post-apocalyptic anything. I saw Mad Max as a wee lad and was ever since hooked on the whole idea of a destroyed world with the survivors of the nuclear fire battling it out for dominance. And also, I love Patrick Swayze. I love him so much it's like ass in my mouth.
I know you want me so bad it's like ass in your mouth.
I've seen a lot of his movies. Up until recently, I thought I'd seen everything he'd done. Apparently fucking not. A post-apocalyptic film where Patrick Swayze is a nomadic loner badass with a windswept mullet called Steel Dawn? Oh my god, how? How the hell did it take me to the age of 24 to finally learn of the existence of such a thing? My first question was, is this a sequel to Red Dawn? Because I thought Swayze died at the end of that thing. Apparently not. The war between America and communism destroyed civilization, and from the rubble of the old world, we were given a new hero. Steel Dawn wastes little time in ramming the size of its cojones in your face as we begin with Swayze, who is meditating via doing a headstand in the middle of the desert. He's attacked by crab people who live under the sand. The Lovecraftian gang of scavengers are no match for Swayze. You're probably wondering, who were they? Were those actually tentacles growing from their faces? Do they ever show up again? They sure fucking don't! Swayze has a chance encounter with his old master that taught him the ways of Roadhouse. He's bald, he's Asian, and he's old. Therefore, he's fantastic at beating people up. Swayze's master became a peacekeeper. Before that could really be elaborated on, a gang of wasteland punks rushed the tavern, and at some point earlier, managed to drug Swayze's drink.
That or he's just clumsy and knocks himself out for the duration of the scene.
I mean, it looks like he reaches for something, but then falls the fuck over and clonks his head. But Swayze is more coordinated than that, so we'll go with drugged. Anyway, so with Swayze blackout drunk on the floor, his old master faces the punks on his own. He's ultimately killed by this fabulous motherfucker, which results in Swayze becoming a grizzled nomad that wanders the wasteland, fueled by revenge.
Well, actually, that's what he already was. His family died during the big war, so he became a loner.
Now with his master dead, he does the same thing, he just looks grizzled. Or about as grizzled as you could make Patrick Swayze look. So he has officially reached loner hero status. Everyone important in his life is dead, and now he's a broken wanderer. Well, an even more broken wanderer. Bent on revengeance. He forms an immediate friendship with a dog by simply looking at it. With his new canine friend, Swayze stumbles on Skywalker Ranch. It's a purification farm, clean water, crops, and all that shit.
I'm sure somewhere nearby, there's bound to be an oil refinery that a grizzled shoulder pad sporting Mel Gibson just arrived at.
Swayze offers his services and he's taken into the settlement by Kasha. He'll be working with Tark and Hui. Tark is the foreman and Hui already can't get enough of Swayze. Tark takes offense to this and gets all alpha male.
You might as well know the layout from the start. I'm head dog on this farm.
Dude, he's Patrick fucking Swayze. Trying to give him orders is like telling the wind not to blow. Consider yourself replaced.
So Swayze is doing well. Apart from forming a bond with that random wasteland dog, he also forms a bond with Kasha's son, Jux, whose father died in the war.
I knew him.
You knew him?
He was a great man.
Well, that's convenient. During a town meeting, Damn Nil, the Resident Evil warlord motherfucker of the area, shows up to throw his weight around. It's evident by this point that Swayze's master was meant to be the peacekeeper around here, but that lousy Damn Nil had him taken out.
I am the authority in this valley!
The next day they go into town for a new pump. Some of Damn Nil's fuckboys decide to harass Tark for looking like Hulk Hogan.
When he's overwhelmed, Swayze steps in and clobbers them. Let's take note of this. Upon Swayze saving his life, Tark decides to root through Swayze's shit and decides, since he's an insecure macho prat, that Swayze isn't to be trusted and should die because he has weapons. Tark is a piece of shit.
Where did you learn to fight?
I was a soldier.
You know, that dad of yours that was a soldier that Swayze was in the war with? This kid has the memory of a fucking brick. Swayze wakes up in the middle of the night to spot scavengers breaking into the settlement. Swayze stops them and goes back to sleep before Tark and Kasha even respond. I bet Tark really wants to fuck. I mean, kill Swayze now.
You have a healthy appetite.
You're too polite, I eat like a pig.
I'm gonna go on record in stating that pig and Patrick Swayze do not belong in the same sentence. Unless it's Patrick Swayze just cross-kicked a pig into a neatly set portion of bacon. The man can do no wrong. Okay, almost. He still looks hot in drag, though. Kasha tells Swayze about the settlement's secret. It's a fresh, natural source of uncontaminated water, right underground, an endless supply. She's going to irrigate the entire valley so each farm can have its own source of water. Swayze's apprehensive about the idea because of that damn nil. Meanwhile, Swayze bathes in a little tub out in the open. Why? Because he's Patrick fucking Swayze. This is fan service no matter who you are.
What's the matter? Never seen a grown man naked?
Damn nil interrupts bath time. He wants Swayze to join his wasteland brigade of suck-ass failure junkies, or the settlers will be in trouble. Nil more than implies wanting Swayze for a little more than just being another soldier. But Patrick Swayze is just a sexy boy. He's nobody's boy toy.
You shouldn't play with sharp objects.
Swayze has a meditating session in the middle of the night. Man, you can tell how fucking uncomfortable he is. Look at that pained expression. He's trying so hard not to shake. A romance blossoms between Swayze and Kasha, because if you have a hetero male and a hetero woman, they need to have sex sometime before the third act. When they get back to the farm, it's been ransacked. Damn nil ruined the fucking pumps! Actually, sex ruined the fucking pumps. Swayze would have kipped up from his meditating session and whooped all ass. Swayze treats this like fraternity warfare, so he takes off with Tark to Damn Nil's farm to steal a valve. They stumble on some wasteland ladies getting undressed in front of each other. Tark acts like he's never seen a woman before. They dispatch some guards. Swayze handles two guys by himself just fine. Tark has trouble knocking one out. They stow the valve on a carriage, which they infiltrate when it leaves the village. Tark gets zero credit from the settlement for the stealing of the pump, which, to be honest, I sort of agree with. He only really helped Swayze carry the fucking thing. Swayze did most of the fighting, including the commandeering of an in-motion carriage.
Yes, I've got heartaches by the number, troubles by the score.
The man that killed Swayze's master is finally back on screen, and thank Christ for that, because he's fantastic.
Please don't insult me. I want this to be sporting.
I don't suppose any of these peasants have a sword they can lend you?
It isn't a post-apocalyptic movie without a flagrantly homosexual villain. More on this subject later. The fabulous assassin beats the shit out of Swayze for the most part, but when Swayze starts winning a little bit, Damn Nil's men jump in. Tark tries to run in for the save, but is gutted. The hair metal warrior is fucking livid over Nil's damn men interfering in his honorable bout with sexy Swayze. There's no bullshit or ulterior motive. This guy just really wants to fight Swayze. So much so that it just might turn him on a little bit. Jux is taken hostage, and Kasha feels responsible.
If I hadn't pushed Damn Nil, Tark would still be alive, and Jux would be safe.
It's not you. It's me. I attract violence.
If you really need to break up with somebody, there's your line. Kasha tricks Swayze into getting his sword and locks him in the room so she can go rescue Jux. I don't know about you folks following along, but wouldn't you want the highly trained death machine with you on your mission to rescue your son from a fucking gang of post-nuclear badasses? Taking on a dozen armed motherfuckers in combat, no big deal. But busting a door down? Therein lies the real challenge. Kasha makes it into Damn Nil's settlement, and actually manages to get him at knife point. Jux gets away, but Kasha ends up taken hostage in his place. Jux tries to take off in this thing that might be this vehicle that they may have been trying to build up earlier in the film.
What are you building?
A wind racer.
the fuck is a wind racer? Might be that thing. Swayze promised Jux in like one brief scene that he'd help him build this wind racer thing. We never actually see that. Knowing what it is doesn't really matter at all. The only purpose it serves is to create the coolest looking shot in the trailer.
This is his challenge.
I gotta see this shit. And the endgame is here. Swayze versus the Fabulous Assassin. The Battle of the Mullets is about to begin. For those disappointed by the lack of sword fighting in the film adaptation of The Keep, there's your precious fucking sword fight finale. To be honest, this is a pretty epic battle. Very intense and fast-paced. The Assassin does appear to be a slightly better fighter than Swayze, which you want in a villain. You want to see the hero up against a challenge, a motherfucker that actually makes him bleed, that pushes him to his very limit. Damnil decides to intervene by sending in his soldiers to kill Swayze. This really pisses off our glamorous post-nuclear warlord. He promised beheadings earlier if one of these assholes tried to interrupt his honorable bout with Swayze, and he fucking delivers.
I warned you not to interfere!
You're the best competition I've ever had. But no one is better than me.
I fucking love this guy, and I fucking love this movie. You know how it ends. Swayze defeats the bad guys, saves the girl, peace is restored, blah blah blah. I think the logical closure point would have been better, though. When fucking Swayze and Glamour Warrior are staring each other down, instead of continuing the battle, they just start making out. Cut to Kasha and Damnil looking all befuddled. Roll credits. Seriously, though, Steel Dawn is a lot of fun. It's one of the few films that Lance Houle actually directed. He's an executive producer and has producer credits on all kinds of movies. It's actually a pretty random-ass list. Missing in Action, Crocodile Dundee in Los Angeles, and Man on Fire, to name a few. Christopher Neame played the Fabulous Assassin, and it's no surprise that he pulled it off as well as he did. He was Johnny Alucard in the Hammer film Dracula AD 1972, which is the role that got him noticed. He's pretty fucking fabulous in that one, too. Steel Dawn is one of the first movies that Arnold Vosloo was in. I swear this motherfucker never ages or something. I used to think he was in his mid-20s in The Mummy, but he looks the same in Steel Dawn, which was made in 1987. Damnil is played by Anthony Zerbe. He makes for a great villain, and he's been in some awesome movies. My personal favorite Bond film, License to Kill, my favorite Christopher Walken film, The Dead Zone, and the fantastic Omega Man.
How hard it is to admit the truth. Take him to the little room.
If you're a connoisseur of all things post-apocalyptic, I recommend the hell out of Steel Dawn. The obvious comparison would be Road Warrior, but what this movie really reminds me of is Fist of the North Star. In fact, I'd say it probably works better as a live-action adaptation than the actual fucking live-action adaptation.
Fist of the North Star!
No!
What the fuck even? Perhaps I should elaborate for those that don't really know what Fist of the North Star is. Essentially, it's very much what Steel Dawn is, in that it's a nuclear wasteland tale about a lone, embittered warrior with ridiculous fighting skill attained before the world crumbled. And much like Fist of the North Star, the lone hero's enemy is just as highly skilled, if not more so. It all culminates to a battle that proves who the baddest motherfucker of the wasteland is. Even the general visuals in the film remind me of Fist of the North Star. The shipwreck buried in the desert is a lot like the ship smashed through the building in the feature-length manga film. Visuals like that really help in selling a cool post-apocalyptic flick. The locations and what you do with them are just as important as football shoulder pads and S&M gear. Which leads me to Christopher Neame and his portrayal of the post-nuclear warlord that oozes with homoeroticism. The hard gay villain really does seem to be a reoccurring thing in post-apocalyptic flicks. Road Warrior, of course, has the brilliant Lord Humongous, studded leather underpants, S&M He-Man straps, and tennis shoes on the most menacing fucking physique you've ever seen. Another example is the obscure but equally excellent New Barbarians. Now, I don't want to spoil this because I do intend to review it someday, but the bad guy rapes the good guy. No symbolism or implied homoeroticism needed. Lord Humongous fucks Mad Max. Deal with it.